Hello and welcome to episode 2 on how character LCDs work.
So in the last episode I showed you how you can control these screens using nothing but toggle switches. And if you haven't seen that, I suggest you go back and watch that one first.
So in this episode I'm going to try to show how to connect one of these to a computer. And the computer that I'm going to use is the Commodore 64. So you might ask, why a Commodore and not an Atari or an Apple II or something like that? Well, all of the Commodores have something called a user port, and it goes as far back as the Commodore PET.
The VIC-20 has one, the 64 has one, so does the Plus 4 and the 128. The only Commodore machine that really lacks a user port is the Commodore 16, which is fairly rare.
So I have no idea why Commodore called this the user port, but what it really is it's a parallel port and a serial port all combined into one connector. However, for this particular project, we're really only interested in the parallel aspect of the user port.
If you take a look inside the Commodore 64, you'll see it has two 6526 chips. These are input-output chips. And they actually do quite a few things, but what we're interested in are the 16 lines of general purpose input-output that these chips have. There are 32 lines in total between the two chips. These are pretty similar to the general I/O lines you might have on a Raspberry Pi or a microcontroller. However, most of these lines are in use by the computer for things like the keyboard and the joystick ports, the disk drive ports, etc. What we're interested in are the 8 lines of port B. These go straight to the user port and are not used for anything other than whatever we want to use them for. Now, the thing is, 8 lines are not enough to drive an LCD like this because we would need 2 more lines for the enable pin and the register select. However, we can easily solve that problem by operating the screen in 4-bit mode instead of 8-bit mode. And here's how that works. Let's say we wanted to send the number 42 to the screen, since that is the meaning of life, the universe, and everything. Well, we would send this 8-bit binary number to represent that. And it would be assigned to the 8 data pins, just like I showed in the last video. But if we set the screen to 4-bit mode, we would just use the last 4 pins on the screen like this, and we'd send the first 4 bits, and then the next 4 bits. In this mode, the screen will always be expecting 2 bursts of data for every command or every character sent to the screen. So back to our user port diagram, we will only need 6 pins to control the screen instead of 8. Of course, we'll use the ground and plus 5 volts to power the screen. Then we'll use these last 4 lines for the data bits. PB3 can operate the register select, and then PB2 can operate the enable line.
So once we hook up the LCD to the user port, how do we control it?
Well, the 6526 chip occupies a few bytes in the C64's memory map. There are only 2 memory locations that are relevant to us. The first is 56579. This location sets the direction for all 8 lines on the user port. Because it is an 8-bit register, each bit represents one of the 8 data lines. So if you set one of them to a 0, then that line becomes an input line so that we can read the state of that line. If you set it to a 1, then it becomes an output line that you can control. For our purposes, we need it to be an output line. In fact, just to make things easy, we can set them all to be output lines by storing the value 255 in this memory location. The other memory location we need to worry about is 56577. This is where actual reading and writing happens. Since everything is set to output mode, we can actually write an 8-bit value to this register, and each bit represents the state of each pin. Let me demonstrate this for you. So I've got this edge connector that fits the C64 user port. I like to print out little labels and attach them to the sides so that there's no question as to which pins I'm connecting things to. I also like to run a spare piece of wire through these holes on the side so that I have some way to pull the connector back out of the machine when I'm done with it. Now, I'm going to temporarily attach an alligator clip to the ground and another one to PB0. Now I'm going to carefully stick this in the back of my Commodore 64. Next, I'm going to turn on the C64 and type poke 56579,255, which will turn all of the user port pins to output mode. Now, if we look at the voltmeter, you'll see it's reading 0.068 volts, which means the pin is being held low. Now I'm going to type poke 56577,1, which should set that particular pin to a high state. And you'll see the voltage on that pin jumped up to almost 5 volts now, so that is the high state. Okay, so now that we know that works, I'll use that pull wire I put in there to yank this out. Next, I'm going to wire up one of my LCD screens to the user port, so I'll get to soldering. And here we go, a finished product. So I wrote this little test program in BASIC that will send some simple commands to the LCD and allow you to type on the screen. The first thing I'll do is press 5 to set the interface length to 4-bit mode, and then I'll press 4 to send the command to enable the display. However, this is a multi-part command, so my program will also ask if you want the display on, and then if you want the cursor on, and then if you want the cursor to blink. So I said yes to all three. Unfortunately, it didn't work.
So I played around with this screen for hours trying to figure out, you know, did I connect something wrong? You know, what did I do wrong? Well, you know, things don't always go to plan. I actually pulled this screen out of an old piece of equipment a long time ago, and to be honest, I've never even seen this screen work before. So for all I know, there's something wrong with it.
So I decided to pull the screen out of my last contraption with the toggle switches and wire that up the exact same way. However, I knew something was wrong the moment I turned on the power to the C64. The screen displayed garbage like this. Oddly enough, when I ran my program, it actually did initialize the screen, and I was able to type out some characters, even though it was clear the screen was behaving oddly. Unfortunately, even when I connected the screen back to a regular power away from the C64, it still now displays that garbage on the screen permanently.
So I spent the entire next day going over every connection, every detail, checking everything with a voltmeter, checking for continuity, seeing if I could have possibly wired something up wrong, and I simply couldn't find anything that I did wrong. In fact, the really frustrating part about this is I've done this experiment before, about 10 years ago, and it worked fine. So I know it will work. But the only thing I really did different back then was I did power the screen externally. And the reason I did that back then was because I was using a backlit screen, and I didn't think the user port on the Commodore 64 could supply enough milliamps to run both the screen and the backlight.
So I had one more screen handy, and I decided to wire it up so that it gets its 5 volts of power from this USB charger instead of the C64. I also wired up the backlight. Now, just for a comparison, I decided to fire it up here on the bench with just the power and nothing else, and it appears to work as expected. This is exactly what it should look like with power only, and the contrast control is working. So time to test it. I unplugged my little SD card reader for the time being, since I didn't have that 10 years ago when I did this experiment. Then I'll plug in the screen. So the first thing I want to do is just try powering on the screen again before I even turn the C64 on. And already something appears wrong. I can't see the two lines on the screen and the contrast control isn't working. But it didn't take long before I noticed that the main ground wire had come loose, so I need to go re-solder that. Okay, so this is getting more and more tense. This is my last screen, and if I fry this one, I'll have to wait a week while I order some new ones online. However, things went even further south. Now, for some reason, my C64 is dead. I mean, totally dead. So things were not looking good. I mean, I couldn't figure out how I could have fried my C64. Nothing I did should have been able to cause that. The only wires connected to the C64 are these here, and the sheer fact that I was able to send characters to the last screen confirms that these are all hooked to the right place, because if any one of them were not, it wouldn't have worked. And I couldn't see how any of these connections could damage a screen or a C64. So I took the C64 apart and started troubleshooting, and I found the answer.
I didn't catch this on video, but when I checked the voltage on the motherboard, I found that it was reading 8.5 volts. It's supposed to be 5. And so as soon as I saw that, I shut the computer off and I didn't turn it back on because I didn't want to risk further damaging any of the chips, and hence that's why I didn't catch it on video.
However, I measured the voltage on the 5 volt line of the power supply, and look what I got. Dang, 11.5 volts.
So unfortunately, this is a very common failure, if not the most common failure, of all Commodore 64 problems. The power supply will start sending too much voltage when it goes bad, and thus frying the rest of the computer along with it. And I never actually checked the power output coming out of the user port, but obviously it was probably way more than 5 volts, and that was what was frying my screens. So this solves yet another mystery. A few weeks ago, I started work on an episode about speech synthesizer cartridges. And during filming the episode, my cartridge just died. It quit working completely, and I couldn't figure out why. So I had to put that video on hold while I tried to find another working speech synthesizer cartridge. And so I started the LCD video earlier than expected, so that's why I had to run to Fry's to buy those parts rather than ordering them online, which would have been much cheaper. Well, now I know what killed my speech synthesizer cartridge, and apparently this whole thing is just a big coincidence and didn't have anything to do with the experiment I was working on.
On the bright side, since I was powering the third screen externally, hopefully it survived the encounter. So I brought out my Commodore 64C. I'm fairly confident at this point I didn't do anything wrong, so even though I'm nervous, I'm going to proceed with the experiment using this computer. Of course, I got a different power supply and confirmed that it was outputting the correct voltage before plugging it in. Okay, so the screen is powered on and looks normal. It is connected to my C64C. I'm going to power on the 64C and so far everything looks good. So now I'm going to initialize the screen and it looks like that worked. Now I'll adjust the contrast. So now I'll try the little clock program that I wrote. Of course, I wrote all of this in BASIC, so it is kind of slow, but you can see that it does work.
By the way, in theory, it should be possible to connect up to three screens to the user port.
The way you would do that is all three screens would share the exact same four data lines. They'd also share the register select. However, PB2 enable would go to one screen, and then you would use PB1 for the next screen and PB0 for the third screen. That way each screen had its own enable line. So every screen will completely ignore whatever is on the data bus until its very specific enable line is raised high.
I should also mention that you can connect a character LCD like this to an older style MS-DOS computer if it has a parallel port. The concept is almost identical to what I've just shown you using the parallel port on the Commodore 64. However, the PC doesn't really have any easy way for you to go control the registers and stuff of the parallel port like the Commodore 64 does. In fact, that's one of the things I love about working with the old 8-bit computers like these, is that you have so much control over the hardware and you can just boot it right up to BASIC and just type a few commands and turn pins high and low and stuff like that. It's really convenient. Okay, so I had also planned in this episode to show you not just connecting it to the user port, but also connecting a screen to the cartridge port of the Commodore 64. Unfortunately, with all the delays and problems I had earlier in the episode, I've decided that that is going to be split off into a part 3. But I think it's really important that you see a character LCD plugged into the cartridge port, and there's good reason why, which you'll understand when you see. So, stick around for that.